This week we're going to celebrate what has been called the Holy Week or the Passion Week. It's the week when we remember the last week of Jesus' life here on earth, and it's really the week that he procured our salvation. It's the week that he went to the hill, far away stood the old rugged cross. It's the week that he died and was buried, and on the third day, up from the grave, he arose with a mighty triumph over his foes. Truly my favorite week of the year. The forecast is sunny and beautiful. I hope you just have a great week enjoying all these mercies that God has given to us. We have a few more services this week I wanted to announce. I tried everything I could to put together a Thursday night service, and it just got thwarted at every end. So no Thursday night, okay? Sorry, unless you want to sneak over to my house. And I was even going to do that, and I just thought, what if too many people show up? It just wouldn't work. So Friday night, we are going to have a Good Friday service. Pastor Rutland is going to bring us the Word of God, and I've seen the order of service, just some beautiful music I encourage you to be a part of. And then we'll have Resurrection Sunday, where we'll gather and celebrate that he is risen. And this service has traditionally been geared to bring unbelieving friends, to get out and invite friends who have never heard the gospel of Jesus Christ and the hope of what the resurrection of Jesus Christ declares and proclaims. So I encourage you greatly to bring unbelieving friends, family, neighbors, and do some legwork, get out there and bring them in to hear the gospel of Jesus Christ. So may God meet us in a special way this week and renew and strengthen our faith as we gaze upon these foundational truths of Christianity. And let's pray and ask God to do that, and then we'll open the Word. Father, I thank you for this week. Lord, I thank you for what we will remember. We'll remember the Lord Jesus Christ, the one who will come now. And he came to this earth to give his life as a ransom for many. And Lord, death could not hold him. He conquered it. He defeated it. He is now this morning seated at your right hand in absolute victory. God, we thank you for it. That is the hope of every believing heart here this morning. And so I do pray that you'll meet us in a special way this week. God, I pray now for the word that we are going to open up this morning. I ask that you would move in power. God, that you would teach this word to every mind, heart, and the will would be engaged. Lord, use the word of God from Genesis this morning to teach us much. We pray that your name would be glorified. And it's in the name of Jesus Christ that we do pray. Amen. Well, this morning we're going to stay in Genesis. If you'll turn with me to Genesis chapter 4. Again, after Easter, we'll start up 1 Peter. So this will be our last Sunday in Genesis. Unless I can find the resurrection somewhere in it, I'll go there next week. So I wanted something really to introduce us as we begin Holy Week, something to prepare our hearts for the beautiful week that's upon us. Last year, I preached on the triumphal entry where Jesus comes now and he demands of the world to crown me or kill me. There's no in-between. You crown me as king or you kill me, and that's the season that we now enter into. This morning, I want to look at Cain and Abel in Genesis chapter 4. I'm betting I'm the only pastor in the land this morning preaching on Cain and Abel for Palm Sunday. And when I'm done, you're going to say, why doesn't every pastor preach and prepare his church for Holy Week this way? Or you're going to say, that guy just wanted to preach that and he got a crowbar out and made it fit. So let's take a look at the context, and that's going to be much easier than last week. Genesis 37 through 50 with Joseph was a big context. This context is only three chapters, and it starts in Genesis 1 with the beauty of creation. The Godhead has a plan to put the glory of God on display for all of eternity. And it will be worked through the exaltation of the Son of God, the Redeemer of mankind. And so an earth is created to be the stage for this plan to be worked out in time and space. God speaks it, and it is. He creates a universe just by his will. And it depleted absolutely zero of his power. Let there be light, and there was. And it's just so beautiful as you look at this opening book of Genesis. Then he creates man from the dust. And then we see it's not good for the man to be alone, amen? And he says, I will make him a helper suitable for him. And he makes Eve from the rib of Adam, and he brings her to Adam, and Adam is pleased. That's probably the biggest understatement in the Bible. Adam sees woman created and says, this is now bone of my bone and flesh of my flesh. She shall be called woman because she was taken out of man. And so he breaks into song and poetry right out of the gate. Then God gives his purpose for marriage, and he says, for this cause a man shall leave his father and mother and shall cleave to his wife, and the two shall become one flesh. God looks now at his creation. And now with marriage, he kept creating, going, it's good, it's good, it's good. He finishes marriage, and he says, now it is very good. Paradise is completed, amen? There's just a beauty here in Genesis. But the plan of God, I want you to hear that, the plan of God was not for it to stay this way. He had a greater plan to put his glory on display that demanded a fall. So in Genesis 3 now, we have God has a tree that he tells Adam and Eve not to eat from. And if you do, in the day that you do, you will surely die. And Satan comes and he tempts Eve, and she eats from the forbidden tree and gives some to Adam, and they sin, and they died. They're separated from God, and now God comes in the garden, and now they hide from God instead of walk with him in fellowship. They know they're naked. Shame and guilt have now entered the world, and death and paradise has been lost. And then God puts a curse on the devil, and a curse on the man, and a curse on the woman. And I just want to read the curse that he gave to the snake in Genesis 3:14. And the Lord God said to the serpent, because you have done this, cursed are you more than all cattle, and more than every beast of the field. On your belly you shall go, and dust you shall eat all the days of your life. And I will put enmity between you and the woman, and between your seed and between her seed. He shall bruise you on the head, and you shall bruise him on the heel. Here is the seed form of the whole Bible. Here is God's great promise to bring about restoration of this fallen creation. Here is how to have paradise regained. And now the foundation is laid for the rest of redemptive history. And through the righteous seed will come the Messiah. And the Messiah will come and he will crush the serpent's head. He will defeat all the works of the devil and everything that came from this fall. He will defeat it and conquer it. And he will bring in a new humanity. And he will give them back to God on the last day as to Christ, his son, as a bride. Yet from here on out, there are going to be two seeds warring against each other through the rest of Scripture. Throughout Genesis, you're going to have Cain and Abel now fighting. Isaac and Ishmael. Jacob and Esau. Joseph and his brothers that we saw last week. And so it was when Jesus Christ came to this earth, you had the two seeds fighting and warring. And so it is to this day that the unrighteous persecute and they hate the righteous seed. So now Adam and Eve, in our context, have their first baby. They name him Cain. And there's such joy. Here's the picture in Genesis 4 of the first family. And I wonder if Eve thought maybe this might be the seed that's going to crush the serpent's head. Then they were blessed with another child, and they named him Abel. And right away, now we're going to see the fruit of the fall. The two seeds are waging war against each other immediately in Genesis chapter 4. And we're going to watch this drama played out this morning. And so if you'll look with me in Genesis 4 and verse 1, I want you to see the sin that has now come from the fall. Now the man had relations with his wife Eve, and she conceived and gave birth to Cain, and she said, I have gotten a man-child with the help of the Lord. So the man had relations with his wife Eve. The word for relations in the Hebrew is yada, which means to know in a very intimate way. It's used again in chapter 4 in verse 17 and 25. And so to have this intimacy, Eve now conceives, and she gives birth to Cain. The Hebrew word for Cain, it means craftsman or a smith. It really meant a formed thing, a made thing. And so I'm going to name him Cain because I've gotten a made thing from the Lord. The first baby, can you imagine? I think babies are the cutest thing God ever made. I've never seen an ugly one. They're gorgeous, all of them. And here's the first baby that has ever been seen. And so they get this first baby. And then in verse 2, again she gave birth to his brother Abel, and Abel was a keeper of the flocks, but Cain was a tiller of the ground. So they get another child. Abel means a mere breath or brevity of life. It's interesting since he's going to have a very short life. So there must have been so much joy in this home. Two new sons born to this family. Eve would become the mother of all. It's just a great event. Life has so much hope at the birth of a child. But I want you to notice one more thing. Abel was a keeper of the flocks, and Cain was a tiller of the ground, which came about in the last chapter with the fall. The ground is cursed, and man, you're now going to have to work the ground. Very next chapter, here he is in the curse. Cain is having to be a tiller of the ground. Look with me in verse 3. So it came about in the course of time that Cain brought an offering to the Lord of the fruit of the ground. These two sons now are led or commanded to God to go up and worship. We don't know. Are they two boys? Are they men? I don't even know their age. It doesn't tell us that in the text. But the two children, Adam and Eve, they come now and they bring their offerings to God. And it's important to note, Abel was not the good little boy in church every Sunday and very moral, and Cain was the one riding around on camels drinking and chasing women. So many people look at life that way. There's the moral and the immoral. But that is not what we have in our text. Both of these men approached God with an offering of worship. Moses was led by the Spirit to tell us that Cain and Abel, what they brought to God. Cain brought an offering from the fruit of the ground, and Abel brought an offering of the firstlings of his flock and of his fat portions. We're told at the end of verse 4, let me read verse 4, Abel, on his part, brought the firstlings of his flock and of their fat portions, and the Lord had regard for Abel and for his offering. And verse 5, but for Cain and for his offering, he had no regard. So we see that the Lord accepts Abel's offering, but he does not accept Cain's. And so this happy little story of the first family that is so beautiful now takes a turn on this one event. This one event is that God had regard, which means favor, or he accepted it. He accepted Abel's offering, and he had no regard. He did not accept it. He did not have favor for Cain's offering. And this devastated Cain, and it says it made him angry, and his countenance fell, which means his face. He's just pouting, and he's got this pouty little face now. He's so broken up and angry over this issue. God accepts his little brother's offering, and he does not accept his. This is the hinge that the first murder in the history of the world is going to take place on. But before we look at what Cain did because of this, I think the question that has to be answered this morning is why? Why would God accept one's offering and not the other one's? I mean, they both came and brought God a sacrifice. What was so different that God would actually not accept one of the offerings? I thought God accepted all worship, is what I hear today. That's amazing that this morning, some of you brought worship to God that was acceptable, and some of you brought worship to God that was unacceptable. There were some that came and sang the praises of God because you've tasted of his grace. And there were some that came going through the motions, doing the external things that didn't come here to worship the living God. So there are two kinds of sacrifices being offered. It's hard to find why in the text. And I think that might be the brilliance of the text. Just look at it at face value. One is raising vegetables, and he brings some produce to God. One is raising animals, and he brings an animal to God. So both make an offering to God from their produce, from their jobs. Why then? What is the big difference? And for me, then, it has to be a matter of the heart, since we really can't find anything in the outward actions that just scream and give it away. There has to be something different in the hearts of these two bringing offerings to God. And I've heard many different reasons this week trying to figure it out. One said Cain brought vegetables, and it didn't say he brought the first fruits. So he didn't bring his very first fruits that were to be given to God. But the text doesn't tell us that one way or the other. Abel brought a blood sacrifice, which later Israel was commanded to offer. They make a big deal. It's the same Hebrew word that's later that you're to bring a blood offering, so it has to be that. But at this time in redemptive history, none of that's been revealed. When Adam and Eve realized they were naked, God slew an animal and made skins for them. That tells us that God right there required blood offerings. I do not see that in this text. That tells me that God made them some clothes, and we are never told that now you can only offer a blood sacrifice to be pleasing to God. That's just a stretch to try to do that. Did you grow up with those stretch Armstrongs? If you're old enough, that's all that is. That's a big stretch. I think it's something way deeper than that's going on in this text. It's the same issue that we're going to see addressed again and again throughout the Old Testament and the New Testament and in our everyday lives. God does not just want sacrifice of bulls and goats. That is not the issue. Israel did that. That's not what he wanted. He said, I want your heart. If Cain would have brought a blood sacrifice, he still had a gnarly, rotten heart that's going to come out this morning in our text. Blood sacrifice was not the problem with Cain's heart. I want you to listen to Isaiah and what he wrote in Isaiah 1:10. Just listen to these words. Hear the word of the Lord, you rulers of Sodom. Give ear to the instruction of our God, you people of Gomorrah. What are your multiplied sacrifices to me? Blood sacrifices, says the Lord. I've had enough of burnt offerings of rams and the fat of fed cattle. I take no pleasure in the blood of bulls and lambs or goats. When you come to appear before me, who requires of you this trampling of my courts? Bring your worthless offerings no longer. Incense is an abomination to me. New moon and Sabbath, the calling of assemblies. I cannot endure iniquity in the solemn assembly. I hate your new moon festivals and your appointed feasts. They've become a burden to me. I'm weary of bearing them, says God. So when you spread out your hands in prayer, I will hide my eyes from you like with Cain here. Yes, even though you multiply prayers, I will not listen. Your hands are covered with blood, as Cain's will be very shortly. Wash yourselves, make yourselves clean, remove the evil of your deeds from my sight, cease to do evil. Learn to do good and seek justice and reprove the ruthless, defend the orphan and plead for the widow. Come now and let us reason together, says the Lord. Though your sins are as scarlet, they will be as white as snow. Though they are red like crimson, they will be like wool. If you consent and obey, you will eat the best of the land. But if you refuse and rebel, you will be devoured by the sword. Truly the mouth of the Lord has spoken. So this has been the history of the world since the fall. There are true worshipers and there are false worshipers. There's one who's been accepted and there's one who's not accepted. There are those who are not accepted and they hate those who are accepted. They literally hate the righteous. There's an enmity between the two seeds that we saw at the curse, and it is still alive and well in our day. I see this stuff going on right now in families and in churches all the time. Even people who will name the name of the Lord, and they hate those who are truly righteous. And there's a bitterness, and there's an enmity between the two seeds. So there may be some clues in this text as to why God did not accept one and accepted the other. Cain brings the fruits of the soil. Abel brings the firstlings, the fat portions. So we know for sure that Abel gave God his very best. There may be more as to why he gave God his best. I'm sure that his parents taught him since birth about what had happened in the garden. I have no doubt. The promise that there was this fall and the devil tempted them and they fell and all that had happened and God promised to crush the serpent's head and he will bruise him on the heel. And so I'm sure that Abel and Cain had grown up under this teaching. And so listen to what the writer of Hebrews tells us. In Hebrews 11:4, by faith, Abel offered to God a better sacrifice than Cain. So right away, what we're learning then is that it was by faith that Cain or Abel gave a better sacrifice. He gave something better than Cain through which he obtained the testimony that he was righteous. God testifying about his gifts, and through faith, though he is dead, he still speaks. So something led Abel to bring his very best to God, his fat portions, his very first ones. He gave God the best that he had. And why did you do that? Because by faith. Faith. It says this, the testimony that he was righteous. And that's what it said about Abraham. He believed God, and it was credited to him as righteousness, we saw about a month ago. So there's some kind of faith that he had, Abel had, in a promise. And there's faith that he sees a value in God to give him his very best. So there is faith. And because there's faith, I see value in God. I will give him my very best. And there could be faith in this promise of God's restoration through the seed. Did Cain have faith? He had to believe God existed, wouldn't you say? He's going to have a conversation with him in our text. He had to somehow have known that his sacrifice was not regarded. Someone had to tell him that. But he did not have what Abel had. He did not have a faith in God. He trusted, who trusted in his promise and saw his value. That is what I see absent in the seed that persecutes the righteous. They profess, but by their deeds they deny him. Cain professes, but by his very offering he's denying that he has real faith and knows God. They don't see a value in God to give them their lives and to offer up worship to him as their very best and not give God their leftovers. This is what that seed will do. They'll be external people, and they'll never see that value in God and say, I will give you my heart. I will give you everything because you are worthy. And as a pastor, I deal with these two kinds of people on a daily basis. There's a lot of religious people, and there are those who see this like Abel. And there are those who see this like Cain, and you just kind of bring some of the fruit of the ground, and there's not this heart, faith, worship of God. There are two reasons to offer up a sacrifice to God in worship. One is because it's a response to salvation. In Romans 12, offer up your bodies a living sacrifice to God. So it's a response to the mercies of God that we've received in Christ Jesus. Or it's offered as a means to salvation. I do all of these things for God so he'll bless me and reward me and draw me near and accept me. So there's just two kinds of offerings that can be made. And we see this in their responses. Abel, God's grace alone, everything you give God is grace. I worship you. Cain, you owe me God because I've done so much. Why do you think he's so mad? Why do you think Cain is so furious? Can you think of two brothers maybe like these two guys? I'm thinking of the prodigal son and his brother later in Luke. And the prodigal son says, God, I don't want you. I want what you can give me. Give me my inheritance. And he leaves and he goes and is in the pig slop and he squanders it and finally realizes that life was better with the father, comes back. I just want to be a hired hand. And the father runs. He lifts his skirt and he receives him and he puts a ring on his finger and he kills the fattened calf. And there's this great excitement because my son that was lost has returned. And then there's the older brother sitting there just hating him. He's jealous that the father's giving mercy to the other brother. What about me? I did everything right. I've done everything. You've never thrown a party for me. And that's right there are the two seeds perfectly pictured. One's receiving mercy and grace, and the other one's bitter because he is. And I'm such a good person. I've done so many things. You should be rewarding me. I should be getting the favor. Look at my life. Look who I am. And that is the two seeds to this very day. When you are a legalist, God owes you because of all that you've done to serve and worship him. And you become angry when he doesn't give you what you want because God owes me. Cain sees Abel being received and he becomes so angry and downcast. I'm better than he is. I've labored hard in the gardens. I deserve to be accepted. And you're always mad and grumpy because others are blessed ahead of you. A legalist cannot handle others being blessed ahead of you. They can't. them not getting special treatment by God or the treatment that they think they deserve, they just live a life of anger. They're always angry and they're always bitter. And so I think we can find it right here in our text in Hebrews 11 that Cain brought the fruit of the ground. His heart wasn't right. And Abel, by faith, his heart was right. And he gave God his very best in worship. And so God received what Abel had to give. And he rejects that kind of worship, that fake, false, legalistic worship. It's rejected. Cain's response, I believe, will show the hardness of his heart. He hates Abel. Now, what I've seen in my life is that Cain's hate Abel's, but Abel's don't hate Cain's. And he hates Abel now. And he hates God. He's going to talk disrespectful to God. Am I my brother's keeper? Look with me in verse 6. I want you to see the graciousness of God in this response. So the Lord said to Cain, "Why are you angry, and why has your countenance fallen? If you do well, will not your countenance be lifted up? And if you do not do well, sin is crouching at the door, and its desire is for you. But you must master it." And so I want you to understand, this is not God trying to understand what's going on. This is God trying to help Cain understand what's going on in his heart. And so there's a graciousness in how God is dealing with him. He's asking questions to get to his heart. You could almost say he's counseling Cain. He's trying to show him and reveal. He could have just brought judgment on him right there. And he tells him the right response. Cain, repent. Do what is right. Turn. If you do well, which is faith like your brother, and offer with a right heart of worship to me, your countenance will be lifted up. It is sin and bitterness that has you this way. Don't hate Abel and don't hate me. Hate yourself. Repent of this evil that is in your heart, Cain. By faith, come and worship me rightly. Isn't that how a believer would respond? What would you do if God told you that? I pray that every believer would say, I would be brokenhearted. I would repent and say, God, let me give you real worship. If you came here today with a false worship, I pray your heart would say, I came here with my mind and everything else. I want to repent and worship you, God. This is how we know his heart was so wrong, because he will not repent even at God's pleading and evangelism. He has God himself preaching him the gospel. And he won't repent. He won't let go. That's how I can die on the hill. This is a hard heart, and that's why his worship was not accepted. And I want you to see the deepness of sin. In verse 7, if you do well, and will not your countenance be lifted up? And if you do not do well, sin is crouching at the door, and its desire is for you. God gives them a warning. If you do not do well, Cain, if you don't repent and have faith, sin is crouching at the door, and its desire is, it's for you, but you must master it. The Hebrew word for crouching was an animal or a predator. We'll pull out a lion. I want you just to picture a lion crouching in the shadows, coiled and ready to kill his prey. Sin is personified here as a predator crouching in the weeds or the bushes, just waiting to trounce on you and devour you. It wants to destroy you, Cain. Why would we ever play with sin? See how close we can get to it. Can a man play with fire and not get burned? Sin is not just something you do. It's not an S chromosome passed down. It's not just a choice. Sin has a deadly life of its own. Sin has a growing and abiding life. It's a force. It's an action. It takes shape and it grows. First you sin and then it does you. It's a desire. It's for you. It's to control you, to dominate, take over you. Feed this lion and it will devour you, Cain. Look at what it did to Cain. It was crouching. He was warned and he fed it. And it pounced on him, and it absolutely destroyed this man to eternal perdition. To where now his heart will even kill and murder his own brother. So I want you to see this morning that sin hides and it crouches. The worst sins in your lives are the ones that are ruining you and ruining others. They're the ones that you won't admit, the ones that you rationalize or you minimize. I'm not a workaholic, I'm just responsible. I'm not greedy, I'm just a good steward. I'm not full of lust, I just enjoy good conversation. I'm not dead to God, I just need to work harder when I'm ready. I'm not a sinner, I just make bad choices sometimes. Sin is not your friend. It's enmity against God, it's absolute defiance. And it's a power waiting to devour. And God says, Cain, you must master it. And I want you to look with me in verse 8, how it pounced on Cain, who was so bitter and angry because of his sacrifice not being accepted. Look in verse 8. And Cain told Abel, his brother. And it came about when they were in the field, so he leads them out into the field, that Cain rose up against Abel, his brother, and he killed him. And so there weren't guns or swords or anything. And so Cain takes Abel out into to the land and with his bare hands. I don't know if he grabbed a rock or bare hands, but he comes now and he beats his brother to death. And the beautiful paradise that we saw that God made, now because of the fall, it's now the ground is drinking up the blood of Abel. Because his brother rose up against him in all of his anger and bitterness, and he killed even his own brother. In verse 9, then the Lord said to Cain, where is Abel, your brother? And he said, I do not know. Am I my brother's keeper? So he must have fled from it. And now God's asking him, where's your brother? And again, this is not because God's trying to get information. God knows what's going on. I don't know, in the bitterness of his heart, am I my brother's keeper to God? It's just such a sad story, isn't it? It breaks my heart that a brother could kill his own brother with his own hands because God accepted his worship and not his. Can I give you any hope this morning? Did I just come here to tell you a sad story? Don't you hate sad endings and you got to leave? I'm not going to do that to you. Do I just send you home with a sad ending? And say, give God your best and fight sin because it's crouching. Be like Abel and don't be like Cain. There's truth in that. But I want to read verse 10, and I want to read it to you and lead you to a very happy ending. I like happy endings. Do you? I love them. And so look with me in verse 10. And he said, what have you done? The voice of your brother's blood is crying to me from the ground. Your brother's blood is crying up to me in heaven. Your brother's blood is speaking. And it's speaking of the realities of the fall, this glorious paradise. And now a brother has killed his own brother over jealousy and anger. What a stark contrast to it is very good. This blood is now speaking of the fall of mankind. It speaks to the sin that has come into the world and into the hearts of man. It speaks to the enmity between the two seeds going on right now. It's now blood crying up to God saying, avenge me. Bring justice. I've been wrong. Bring condemnation. It's an innocent blood, and it's been shed because it was righteous, and now it's speaking. This blood is crying murder from the one who came from the same womb of the same mother. It's crying for revenge. Oh my. What I want to do in closing has been done through everything we've looked at in Genesis because it's called the beginnings, is I want to follow history and I want you to come with me and see where it moves. Because many years later, another man showed up on this earth and the nation was filled with Cains. They were very religious. They were called Pharisees, and those two, they made offerings to God on a daily basis. They offered the blood of bulls and goats, but they were very, very self-righteous. And the Son of God came, and he didn't accept their sacrifices. He actually condemned them because their hearts weren't right. And they thought Jesus would come and just say, you guys are the best, you're the example. And he comes and he says, you guys aren't the example, and you're not going to get into the kingdom of heaven. And when they were told that they would not inherit the kingdom of God, and all of a sudden prostitutes and sinners and tax collectors are being brought into the kingdom of God, they were furious. That seed hated the other seed that was getting saved. They hated it. And they hated him. And they took the most righteous one who had ever lived on this earth, who worshiped God the Father rightly and beautifully throughout the Gospels, and they trumped up a bunch of charges on him. And they got the verdict of death by crucifixion. And they led him to a cross where he was nailed to it. And his blood was shed, and again, it soaked the earth's ground. But his blood cried out as well. His blood speaks as well. And I just want to read one verse to you. Not one verse, but six. Listen to Hebrews chapter 12. The writer says, "For you have not come to a mountain that may be touched, and to a blazing fire, and to darkness and gloom and whirlwind." This is when the giving of the old covenant came. They couldn't even touch the mountain. "And to the blast of a trumpet and the sound of words, which sound was such that those who heard begged that no further word should be spoken to them. For they could not bear the command. If even a beast touches the mountain, it will be stoned, because the Holy God has descended on it. And so terrible was the sight that Moses said, 'I am full of fear and trembling.'" That's the giving of the old covenant. And now he says, here's the giving of the new covenant. "You've come to Mount Zion and to the city of the living God, the heavenly Jerusalem, and to the myriads of angels, to the general assembly and church of the firstborn who are enrolled in heaven, and to God, the judge of all, and to the spirits of righteous men made perfect. And you have come to Jesus, the mediator of a new covenant, and to the sprinkled blood, which speaks better than the blood of Abel." He was so beautiful. And the Cains hated him, just like they do today. They hate truly righteous people who manifest Jesus Christ. And he died. But this was by design to bring about salvation. This was designed so that he would crush the serpent's head while the serpent bruised him on the heel. And so the work that the devil did in the garden, Jesus undid at the cross. And he defeated him, and he gave him that blow to the head. And all the destruction that came from the devil and leading Adam and Eve into sin in the fall has been brought back in Jesus Christ. He paid the penalty of God's justice for our injustices. And now his blood speaks something different, something better than Abel. His blood speaks to those who have murdered and killed and who he died for. His blood speaks forgiveness to all who will come to him by faith, who will worship him and give him their fat portions, their very best, and will find forgiveness for all of their sins. "I will separate them as far as the east is from the west. I'll remember their sins no more." So his blood didn't cry for justice. He received justice. And his blood now speaks to God of forgiveness for all of your sin. Isn't that better than the blood of Abel? Listen to what he said. "Cain, sin is crouching at your door and its desire is for you. You must master it. Sin cannot have dominion over you." And as Top Lady wrote, at the cross, there's the double cure: to save from wrath and make me pure. And so he can save me from the wrath of God that I deserve for my sins. And in this work, it can also make me pure. And so this is how we master sin. At the cross, the dominion of sin was broken. And it cannot control and be the sovereign of a believer ever again, because there's a new sheriff in town, and his name is Jesus Christ, and he rules and reigns your life. And so the dominion of sin is broken. You are joined to Jesus Christ as a new ruler and master. And because Jesus is your ruler and master, sin can never have dominion over you again. Its tyranny has been broken at the cross, at the resurrection. The proclamation is that the dominion of sin has been broken for the believer. This is the beauty. "I will struggle and battle sin till I die or he comes back. but it can never own me like it did when I was in Adam. As every time I fall into it again, God leads me to repentance. And I am empowered to fight the crouching lion now through the gospel of Jesus Christ, to the power of being joined to my Savior. And so this is how we can overcome that power. It has been broken at the cross, and on Sunday it is broken at the resurrection of Jesus Christ and our resurrection from the dead. And so I pray, as we journey together this week, that we might spend time in examination. Do you know what your crouching sins are? Just some time of examination. What are my crouching sins? What are these ones? And to spend time in examination and confession and repentance. And then we're going to come on Friday and Sunday, and we're just going to look at Jesus Christ by faith and believe and give him the worship that he is due. Sin is crouching at our door to devour us, but it will be devoured by the blood of Jesus Christ. To God be the glory for such a Savior as this. And I pray this week that we would gaze and look at him and find this freedom, this glorious beauty that has come in Christ Jesus. And I can't thank God enough for a blood that speaks better than the blood of Abel, a blood that speaks forgiveness of sins. That's the best news that you could ever be told as sinners. And I pray that you treasure this Christ and rejoice in him this week. Let's pray. Father, I thank you for this passage. I thank you for just revealing the seeds that are embattled now because of the fall. The seed of the devil and the seed of the woman, the righteous seed that would bring about a Savior. God, you get children now by faith, grace through faith. And I thank you that we are of the seed, those who have faith, we are of the seed of Abraham, we are of the seed of righteousness. God, I rejoice that now the blood of Christ speaks forgiveness to our sins. And God, there are some who are sitting here who are from the seed of Cain. Lord, they do external religion, but in their heart they truly hate you when they don't get what they want, when you're not their sugar daddy. Lord, they hate you at the core of their being, and they really even hate their own family members, their own friends who are righteous, whose sacrifices have been accepted by you. And they feel a bitterness towards it and say, oh, they're so religious, you're overdoing this. God, I pray that even now that they would be convicted, that sin has crouched at their door and it's going to devour them, and they will end up as Cain did under the judgment of God. Lord, I pray that they would not be able to get that off their conscience, that the only thing that can ever remove this guilt and shame that they feel would be the blood that speaks better than the blood of Abel. God, I pray today that they would come to Jesus for that cleansing power. Are you washed in the Lamb? God, I pray, give them eyes to look at Jesus Christ, who could break the dominion of their sin. God, let them believe upon him for their remedy instead of their own hands and their own bootstraps. Let them today call upon the name of the Lord and be saved. And it's in Christ's name that we pray these things. Amen.